welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, Bryan Lynn has a report about the return of cultural art pieces stolen from Cambodia. Mario Ritter Jr. and Caty Weaver present this week's education report. We close the show with a visit to Shenandoah National Park. But first,
Cambodia has celebrated the return of numerous cultural art pieces stolen during the country's civil war period. Prime Minister Hun Manet recently led a ceremony to welcome the pieces, called artifacts, back to Cambodia. The event took place at the nation's Peace Palace in Phnom Penh. The palace houses the government's official headquarters. The Cambodian leader said a total of 70 ancient statues had been reunited with the country's people. Most of the pieces are believed to have been stolen during Cambodia's civil war period from 1967 until 1975. At the time, the communist Khmer Rouge ruled Cambodia. It is blamed for the killings of more than 1 million Cambodians during its rule and years of unrest and economic difficulties. Multiple international efforts over the years have helped Cambodia get back its artistic and archaeological treasures. The stolen artifacts include ancient pieces from Asia, as well as artwork lost or stolen in conflict areas such as Syria, Iraq, and Nazi-occupied Europe. A total of 70 Khmer cultural objects have been returned through a range of different processes. Cambodia's Ministry of Culture and Fine Arts said in a statement, "These included voluntary returns, negotiations, seizures, and legal processes." The statement said the returned artifacts included important Hindu and Buddhist pieces from the 9th to 14th century. Among them were priceless stone statues representing mythical Hindu figures, it added. Hun Manet said that from 1996 until last month, 1,098 artifacts had been returned to Cambodia. About half were from private collections and half from foreign groups or governments. Officials said the 70 items presented included 14 that arrived from New York's Metropolitan Museum of Art in early July. The rest, from private collectors, arrived in late July. The pieces that came from the Metropolitan Museum were bought and trafficked by well-known art dealer Douglas Latchford. He had been indicted in 2019 on charges linked to an effort that sought to sell stolen Cambodian artifacts on the international art market. Latchford, who died the following year, had denied any involvement in smuggling. A statement from the U.S. Embassy in Cambodia said the U.S. government had assisted the country with the return of over 150 ancient cultural pieces. embassy official Bridget Walker told ceremony attendees that the United States had long been a dependable partner for protecting the cultural heritage of Cambodia. I'm Bryan Lynn.
As students return to college across the United States, administrators are preparing for new activism against the war in Gaza. Some have adopted new rules limiting protests. Last spring, college protests resulted in damage, conflict, and arrests at several schools. The summer break brought most protests to an end, but the results of the damage last spring are still being felt. At Columbia University in New York City, Manu Shafiq resigned from her position as president earlier this month. In April, Shafiq faced strong criticism from lawmakers over her response to protests at Columbia.
Some universities are putting new measures in place to avoid what happened at Columbia. The new rules include banning encampments and limiting the duration of demonstrations. They permit protests only in defined areas and restrict campus access to those with university identification. Critics say some of the measures will hurt free speech. The American Association of University Professors, AAUP, released a statement earlier this month condemning overly restrictive policies that would harm free expression. The AAUP said, "Our colleges and universities should encourage, not suppress, open and vigorous dialogue and debate, even on the most deeply held beliefs." The University of Pennsylvania has released temporary guidelines for student protests. Overnight demonstrations are banned, and the use of loud audio equipment is barred after 5 p.m. on days when classes are being held. Signs, posters, and banners must be removed after 2 weeks. The university says it remains supportive of freedom of speech and lawful assembly. At Indiana University, protests after 11 p.m. are banned under a new expressive activities policy, which took effect on August 1st. The policy bars camping or placing a shelter on campus. Signs require approval from school officials.
The University of South Florida now requires approval for tents, canopies, banners, signs, and amplifiers. Speech, expression, and assembly rules bar demonstrations after 5 p.m. on weekdays and weekends. Protests are completely banned during the last 2 weeks of a semester. Risa Lieberwitz is a Cornell University professor of labor and employment law and gives legal advice to the AAUP. Lieberwitz said, "I think right now we are seeing a resurgence of repression on campuses that we haven't seen since the late 1960s. However, university officials say free speech cannot interfere with learning. They say the updated rules improve safety on campus. Tensions at many universities increased after October 7, 2023, when Hamas militants attacked southern Israel. Hamas killed 1,200 people, most of whom were civilians. Hamas also took about 250 people hostage. Israel's military operation to answer the attack has continued through the summer. Many student protesters in the U.S. have promised to continue their activism against the Gaza war. They are fueled by information from Hamas's health ministry that says more than 40,000 people have died in the Gaza conflict. Much of that tension appeared in the spring on Columbia's campus. On April 30th, police with riot shields raided a building that pro-Palestinian protesters had occupied at Columbia. Earlier, police had cleared out a tent camp that protesters had set up. Similar protests took place on campuses around the country. It is estimated that more than 3,000 people were arrested in connection with the pro-Palestinian protests.
However, many of the students who were arrested during police actions have had their charges dismissed. Some are still waiting to learn what government lawyers decide. Others have faced suspension from school, had their diplomas withheld, or faced other punishments. Columbia only recently began permitting people with university identification or registered visitors onto campus. Officials said they wanted to limit possible disruptions at the start of the new semester. Shafiq of Columbia was among the university leaders who Congress called on in April to explain what was happening. Lawmakers accused her of not doing enough to deal with concerns about anti-Semitism at Columbia. She announced her resignation weeks before classes are to start on September 3rd. Other university leaders have also stepped down in recent months. University of Pennsylvania President Liz McGill resigned in December. She faced pressure after she appeared before Congress and was unable to say whether calls on campus for the genocide of Jewish people would violate school policy. In January, Harvard University President Claudine Gay resigned after accusations of claiming others' writings as her own, and her statement about free speech given to Congress. I'm Caty Weaver.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.
Mario Ritter Jr. is here now to talk more about this week's education report. Hi, Mario. Thanks for joining me.
Thanks, Ashley. It's good to be talking with you again today.
Earlier this year, protests took place at several college campuses in the United States that made the news. Now, many colleges here have made changes to rules for demonstrations on school grounds, following destructive protests in the spring. Some groups say such moves hurt freedom of speech. This week's report notes criticism from the American Association of University Professors. That group warns against overly restrictive policies that would harm free expression. What else did the group say?
The Professors Association, the AAUP, also said, "Our colleges and universities should encourage, not suppress, open and vigorous dialogue and debate, even on the most deeply held beliefs."
There are a lot of good vocabulary words in that statement. Could you help explain for our listeners what vigorous dialogue and debate means?
Sure, Ashley. Vigorous means strong and full of life, while a dialogue is what we are doing right now, having a discussion. At the university, a debate is a competition between two sides that are arguing for or against an idea. Historically, debate is an effort to persuade others of the rightness of an argument. Debates have rules. The debaters observe the rules, and then those who hear the debate can make up their own minds.
So the Professors Association wanted to raise concerns about policies that might restrict debate over ideas. Can you tell us more about the policies put in place by some of the universities?
Well, Ashley, the University of Pennsylvania banned overnight demonstrations, and Indiana University banned protests after 11 p.m., for example. Many of the restrictions appear to require students to get permission from the university before an event, and not to protest using loud devices for long periods of time or making camps on university grounds. University officials are also responsible for safety on the campuses they supervise. That includes all the students and workers there.
Well, thanks so much for answering those questions, Mario, and thanks to you and Caty for that report.
Thank you for having me on your show.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Today, on our National Parks journey, we visit a mountainous landscape on America's East Coast. Within the park are rocky peaks, rolling green hills, and spectacular waterfalls. It is also home to hundreds of black bears. Welcome to Shenandoah National Park in the state of Virginia. Shenandoah sits in the heart of the Blue Ridge Mountains. The mountains are part of the larger Appalachian Mountain Range. The park's hiking trails, waterfalls, and wildlife appeal to nature lovers and adventurers. Shenandoah National Park is perhaps best known for the road that goes through it, Skyline Drive.
Skyline Drive runs nearly 170 kilometers north to south. It is the only road in the park. There are more than 70 overlooks along the way, where people can pull their car off the road. These overlooks provide visitors with beautiful views of the Shenandoah Valley. The road was built in the 1930s, at a time when the automobile was becoming popular. Shenandoah's north entrance, lies less than 120 kilometers from Washington, D.C. Early planners wanted a major national park like those in the American West, here on the East Coast, close to big cities. In fact, Shenandoah was described as an Eastern park in the Western tradition. And early park planners wanted Skyline Drive to be the single greatest feature of the park.
Denise Machado is a park ranger at Shenandoah. She explains that the park soon became a place for people to escape the noise and heat of big cities.
It was created just so people could kind of get away, a place to escape the big city and the hustle and bustle, the pre-air-conditioned days. You know, this was the place to be. The temperatures were about 10 degrees cooler up here on the mountain.
But Shenandoah's history is not without controversy. To create the place that park planners envisioned, many families were forced to leave behind properties in the Blue Ridge Mountains. Shenandoah National Park was formed from more than 3,000 individual land purchases. They were presented to the federal government by the Commonwealth of Virginia. Shenandoah officially became a national park in 1936. Today, most of the buildings and structures that once stood in the area are long gone. But you can find some signs of the past. A log building called Corbin Cabin still stands. George Corbin, who built the log structure, was forced to leave the land in the late 1930s, just after the creation of the national park. Today, the cabin is operated by the Potomac Appalachian Trail Club. The club permits people to rent the cabin.
Shenandoah National Park has more than 800 kilometers of hiking trails. They take visitors to rocky mountain peaks, grassy meadows, and forested canyons. Hikers are especially drawn to the park's famous waterfalls.
The waterfalls are definitely the most popular. We have 9 waterfalls. Dark Hollow Falls is our most popular. It's a beautiful waterfall. It's a 70-foot waterfall. It's a 1.4-mile hike round trip. It follows along a stream, and you're right at the base of the falls looking up, and you can feel the spray, and, you know, it's a really great experience.
Grace Williams hiked to Dark Hollow Falls with her daughter on her birthday.
My daughter's gift for me to bring me to the national park, and it's on my bucket list. So I always love falls. I like the sound. Water is refreshing. So they did tell us it's a kind of like a moderate hike. I do have knee problems, but I just wanted to challenge it, and I'm glad I came. Yeah, it's beautiful.
Another of Shenandoah's famous hikes is called Old Rag. It is almost 15 kilometers long. To get to the top of Old Rag Mountain, hikers must scramble up large rocks. It is a long and difficult hike, but the views from the top bring hikers from all across the country and world.
Because it is close to many big cities, Shenandoah's trails are often crowded with people. More than 1 million people visit the park each year. Although Shenandoah was created to be an easy escape from big East Coast cities, today it sees visitors from all over the world.
It's amazing how many people you meet that come from far-flung countries and corners of the world. We've had people from Africa. We get a lot of people from Germany, France, Sweden, Netherlands. So you just never know where they're going to come from.
Machado says summer and fall are the most popular times to visit the park. While summer is a good time to enjoy the waterfalls, the fall brings beautiful autumn colors. In the middle of October, the trees begin to lose their leaves. The leaves change from green to different shades of yellow, orange, and red as winter approaches. On weekends in October, it can take up to 2 hours just to get into the park.
Visitors to Shenandoah National Park have a good chance of seeing a black bear. The park is home to between 400 to 600 black bears. It has one of the densest black bear populations of any national park. Denise Machado knows a lot about these black bears. In fact, her nickname is the Bear Lady.
Well, I am known in Shenandoah as the Bear Lady. I see a lot of bears every season. I'm in the park early in the morning, late in the evening. I see anywhere from, 400 or so bears every year. And it's wonderful to see. I never get tired of seeing them. They're all different and they're all, special.
Machado gives visitors advice for what to do if they see a black bear.
So if you see a bear, you want to clap your hands, say, "Hey, bear, hey, bears." They really don't like to be startled. You don't want to try and sneak up on them to get a photo or anything. You want to make sure that they are totally aware you're there.
Malachi and his older brother Brent visited Shenandoah National Park with their parents. The family traveled here from Cincinnati, Ohio. The family hiked the Little Stony Man Trail. Along the way, they came upon a black bear.
I really liked how we could see the animals. We saw a really big bear, and he was really friendly, and he didn't do anything, and he was just eating.
The park's bears and other wildlife are a big part of what attracts so many visitors to Shenandoah. Carol Bear and her husband visited the park from York, Pennsylvania. She said visiting Shenandoah is like a breath of fresh air.
It's just quieter. You hear the birds, you look at trees different. The wind blowing through the fields is just really neat. Ocean.
I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Adam Brock.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.